Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Christ Presbyterian Church's Cool Springs location. It is good to be with you all this morning here in the house of the Lord. We have a very packed worship service today, lots of things. We're going to be receiving some new communing members, some children who have made professions of faith, which is always exciting. And then we're going to have some baptisms. We're going to be in a sermon where we're going to talk about what it means to just hunger for the love of God to be what drives us in our lives. Then we're going to come to the communion table as we do every Sunday. And so lots going on, lots of opportunities for us to reflect on the finished work of Christ in our lives. And so let's just take a moment to prepare our hearts for worship, to quiet and settle ourselves. And then in just a moment, Michael Kuhn will come and lead us in our call to worship this morning.
All right, good morning, everybody. My name is Michael Kuhn, and I'll be leading us through our call to worship in this first little portion of our service today. So please stand with me, and we are going to read together our call to worship. This is from Psalm 33. Peace be with you. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his steadfast love. For our heart is glad in him, because we trust in his holy name. All right, join me in prayer. Dear God, we are thankful to gather in your house today. We thank you for meeting us here. We pray that your spirit would be at work, allow us to see you more clearly, and grow closer to you as a result of our worship today. We pray that it would be pleasing in your eyes. Thank you for this time. Amen.
Let's all sing together. I love it when you guys sing so loud, you don't need us. So let's do it.
Unmeasured love unknown. behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death, the God of life. But no grave could e'er constrain him. Praise the Lord, he is alive. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering the hope. Christ in power resurrected, as he will be when he comes. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Jesus Christ resurrected, as we will be when he comes. One more time. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as he will be when he comes.
You all can be seated. And we're going to enter into a time of confession. So please join me together and let's read this confession from the Book of Common Prayer. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. All right, so please take a few moments now for some silent confession of sin. Brothers and sisters, now hear and rest in this assurance of pardon from Psalm 147, verses 2 through 3 and 5. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. Dear Father, the truth is we're all a bunch of big screw-ups. We fail over and over and over. Even though we may know that you've forgiven us, it's hard for us to believe that oftentimes. Thank you for loving us as your beloved children at all times, in our belief and in our unbelief. Help us to rest in that status that we are your beloved children, boys and girls of the Most High, most powerful God of the universe, has forgiven us for any wrongs we've done in the past, present, and future. We thank you for that unwavering love that you show us over and over again. Thank you, Father. Amen.
Let's stand together. Sing. How deep the Father's love for us. Vast beyond all measure, that he would give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great, searing loss, the Father turned his face away. As wounds near the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
behold the man upon the cross, my guilt on his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying death has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Be seated, please.
You may be seated. This morning we have the opportunity, as I said earlier, to receive some new members, some children who are making professions of faith today and coming to the communion table, and then some baptisms as well. So I'd like to invite the Coons and the Paynes to go ahead and come on up here, and actually I'm going to have you guys get up here on the stage, if you wouldn't mind. If you guys want to just stand right there. And then also we have the Hawthorns and the Bentons and the Dudenhoffers who are going to We're going to have some baptisms with their families, and so we want to invite you to go ahead and come on up as well. And I'll have you on the floor here with the Dudenhoffers on this far end, and then Bentons here in the middle, and then Hawthorns here. How's that? All right. We're going to start with you guys. So one of the things that we do as a part of a Presbyterian church is we have church membership, and church membership is an opportunity for people to publicly profess their faith in Jesus, and also publicly identify as belonging to a particular local church. Because the body of Christ is the church universal, yes, that we as Christians belong to the body of Christ, which is scattered throughout the world and down through time, but we're also called to be part of the body of Christ local, to be part of the local church. And to be a member of the local church, what is required is a desire to be a part of the local church, and then a profession of faith in Jesus, a credible profession of faith. And so as children, which as you see, we baptize children before a profession of faith, which is a continuation of the practice that really has its root in circumcision, where the sign of the covenant was applied to children when they were 8 days old, marking them as belonging to the people of God, with a prayer over them that the Lord would be faithful and just to continue the good work that he's begun. And so when we do the baptisms in a moment, there's nothing magical happening. The water isn't magic. We're not saving a soul with the application of that water, but we are recognizing that the Lord has begun a good work in this child's life by bringing them into a home where the Lord is honored and feared. And we're asking the Lord to continue that work, and we're leaning on him and presuming on him to do that. Now, those children, as they grow up in the church, will often see their parents and other people come to the communion table, and they'll hear teaching in the services and over in the kids' ministry, and the gospel will become more clear to them, and they'll begin to express interest in what it means to have a relationship with Jesus, and we'll lead children through that process. And part of that process leads us to today, where we have Julie Payne and Luke and Emma Kuhn, who are going to answer the membership vows that we ask anybody who takes, who becomes a member here. And these kids have been through a process where Miss Beasley has sat down with them and had a conversation with them about their faith. And I've sat down with them after that. And so now we're at a point where we get to ask you guys these questions, and you will become communing members of the church, which means you'll start coming to the communion table. And so we're going to do this now. We have Julie Payne there, and we have Luke and Emma Kuhn here. And their parents are Jonathan and Maggie and Michael and Megan Kuhn here. And I'm going to ask you these questions, okay? And I just want to ask you to answer according to your conscience. Are you ready? There are five of them. Number one, do you acknowledge yourself to be a sinner in the sight of God, justly deserving his displeasure, and without hope except for his sovereign mercy? Do you? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and the Savior of sinners, and do you receive and rest upon him alone for salvation as he is offered in the gospel? Do you?
I do.
Do you now resolve and promise in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as becomes a follower of Jesus Christ? Do you? Four, just two more. Four, do you promise to support the church in its worship and in its work to the best of your ability? Do you?
I do.
And then finally, do you submit yourself to the government and discipline of the church, and do you promise to strive for its purity and its peace? Do you?
I do.
Amen. Well, friends, family, Christ Presbyterian Church, Cool Springs, we have new members in our midst. A round of applause for these children. Let me say a prayer for these children and for all of us, really, and then we'll move into the baptisms. Father, I thank you so much that what has just happened now is the culmination of you bringing your word and your truth to bear in the lives and the hearts of these children. I thank you, Lord, for the questions that have come up in their minds and hearts, questions that they've asked their parents, questions that they've asked their teachers, in our children's ministry, questions that they've asked me, questions that they've wrestled with in prayer, Lord, to bring them to a place of trusting in you and wanting a relationship with you. Father, we ask that you would preserve them to the end, Lord. We ask that you would hold them up, that they would never know a day where you are not loved and where they don't know your mercy and grace, Lord, but that you would keep them in your care and that you would use them as witnesses for your mercy and grace in the world. And we thank you for them and for their lives and for their families, and we pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen and amen. You all can be seated. And now we have the, I'm going to come by and get that bowl of water that's right there. Right here, go. Part of our process here at the church, part of our process, it sounds so clinical. Part of the life of the church is that we believe in the sacraments of the Lord Jesus Christ that he gave the church to, baptism and the Lord's Supper. And baptism is a sacrament. It's a one-time thing. It's an initiatory rite. And it's something that we do of the children of believing parents, as well as for people who make professions of faith who have never been baptized before. And we do this as a way of acknowledging and signifying the ongoing work of Christ in the lives of these children. And we ask the Lord to continue to preserve that work. And we recognize also the Lord's faithfulness in bringing these children into a home where he is honored and he is feared. And so we have this opportunity to do this. As I said earlier, this is a practice that believers have been observing down through time since the foundation of the church, and even in the Old Testament, the sign of the covenant being applied to children. And so we continue that now. We recognize that baptism doesn't automatically save a child, that they do need to profess faith in Jesus, but even that comes through a work of the Lord's mercy and grace. And so by applying these waters to these children, what we are doing is we're affirming the promises and expressing our desire to embrace these children as part of our church family here at Christ Pres Cool Springs. And so to the parents, I will ask you these vows, and I'll ask you to answer all together. And then I'll ask the congregation one, and then we'll move through individually into the baptisms. So question number one. Oh, I forgot to do introductions. Sorry. this is Ian Andrew Hawthorne. Hi, Ian. And this is Eliza Grace Hawthorne right there. And this is her parents, Jason and Emily Hawthorne. And over here, we have Griffin and Rebecca Benton with Hattie Elizabeth Benton. Hey, Hattie. I'm about to surprise you. And then down there we have Aaron and Rose Marie Dudenhofer, and Noah Charlton Dudenhofer is going to be baptized today, and that's his older brother Joshua right there as well. So let me ask you these vows. To the parents of these precious children, please answer according to your conscience. Do you acknowledge your child's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you? Do you claim God's covenant promises on their behalf? And do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for their salvation as you do for your own? Do you? And then finally, do you now unreservedly dedicate your child to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before them a godly example, that you will pray with them and for them, that you will teach them the doctrines of our holy religion, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord, do you? To the congregation that belongs to these families, let me ask you to stand with them now and ask you a very important question. Do you, as the congregation of Christ Presbyterian Church, Cool Springs, undertake the responsibility of assisting these parents in the Christian nurture of their children? As a way of honoring that vow, let me ask you to respond by saying, I do. And now join me in reading this. This is something that we do here at Christ Pres Cool Springs. We read this old Huguenot blessing over covenant children. As we read these words over these children, may we read them to remind ourselves, too, of the faithfulness of the Lord over time. Let's read this blessing together. Blessed child of the covenant, for you God made the world. For you the prophets and patriarchs were sent. For you the covenants and promises were given. For you God's revelation was written down. For you our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ became a man, lived a perfect life, died upon the cross, and was raised again for your salvation. You cannot possibly know these things now, but we, your church, promise to tell them to you until you make them your own. Amen. You may be seated. Hawthorns, we'll start with you. And let's see. Jason, I'll ask you to hold the water for Ian. This is Ian Andrew Hawthorne. Ian, your name means God is gracious, and it's an old name. It's an old Scottish name. And so you have an old name about the grace of God, which predates time. And so I pray that this would remind you that the grace of God is ancient, that it predates you. The grace and faithfulness of God predates your decisions to love him. It predates your best moments. It predates your worst moments. May you come to know and rest in his mercy and grace early, and remember always that it was established for you before the world was even formed. Ian Andrew Hawthorne, precious child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Can I ask you to hold this? And now we come to Eliza Grace Hawthorne. Hi, Eliza. The name Eliza means pledged to God. God is a God of promises. He's a God of promises made and promises kept. And our hope is that you would never know a day where you don't honor and serve the Lord and where you are not confident in his unwavering affection and love for you. May you know that grace, and may the Lord use your life to make that grace known to others. Eliza Grace Hawthorne, precious child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Benton's. Let me go ahead. Oh, she's sound asleep.
Yeah.
We'll see. This is Hattie Elizabeth Benton. The name Hattie means the ruler of a home, and Elizabeth means my God is my promise. And so as the Lord gives you opportunities to lead others in the ways that you care, and in the ways that you speak, and in the ways that you serve, may he anchor your heart to his faithfulness to you, Hattie. May you rest in him and on him all of your days, and may he use you to show his love and faithfulness to others. Hattie Elizabeth Benton, precious child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Back out. We're good.
Not bad, Hattie. Not bad. Oh. She is still sleeping, for the record. Hi. It's good to see you guys. Hi. How are you? Oh, man. How you doing? Okay. I just want to look at him. He's giving me the eye. All right. Dudenhofer's. The name Noah means rest. And the old meaning of the name Charlton is a place where free people gather. Together, then, Noah, your name speaks of a place where people gather freely to find rest for their souls, which is as good a description of the kingdom of God as there is. So may the Lord use your life to be such a place, a refuge for the weary and a respite for the striving. And may you know that same refuge and respite for yourself. Noah Charlton Dudenhofer, precious child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And amen. Let me pray. Lord, we thank you that even as we've rehearsed what these names mean, that one of the themes that comes up over and over again is that you are a God of grace, and that you operate outside of time, and that your desire and your will is to bring us to peace. And so, Lord, even as we witness and participate in the baptisms here this morning, would you remind us that your love for these children is no different than your love for us. It's no less deep. You love us as much as you love them, and you love us perfectly, and you love us in a way that transcends time. And you give us everything we need for everything you've called us to be. And so we thank you for that. Father, I pray for these families that you would give them everything they need for everything you've called them to do and to be. And the Lord, you would hold them up and that you would use their church home to come alongside them and support them and care for them well. And we thank you for the ways you will work in the lives of these families and children. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Another round of applause for these families here. As they're making their way back to their seats, I have a couple of announcements for us as I shuffle a couple things around up here. First is if you would register your attendance, there are some black books on your rows. You can write your name there and any prayer requests you may have. You can also you can also use the QR code we have. Sorry, I lost my train of thought there for a second. You can use the QR code that's there. It's also on the bulletin to let us know that you were here. That's another way you can do that. Also, giving. We don't pass an offering plate during the service, but we are supported and sustained through the tithes and offerings of the church. We're just a few weeks into the beginning of a new fiscal year. A couple ways you can give is you can go to christpres.org/give, and you can select the Cool Springs congregation and give that way. There's also an offering box on the table in the back there as well. And then two other quick things that are very related to each other. VBS. So, guys,
We're pulling off our own VBS this year, which is, and by we, I mean we, Melanie Beasley is pulling off a VBS for us this year. And it's no small task, and the reason that we're wanting to do this is as an opportunity to invite people into the community that's here. And so for all of you who are participating in VBS as leaders and hosts, there is a, right after this service, there's training. You'll be getting a field guide that looks something like this. It's going to walk you through everything that you need to know. So this is an important thing to be a part of. Lunch will be a part of that as well, for all who stick around for that. And then next week, next Sunday, July 24th, we're going to be hosting a work day after church from 1 to 3. And so if you'd like to help transform this place into a place that's just so welcoming for kids and families and ready for the program, we really need the help for all of that. This is everybody pitching in together. It's a huge undertaking for our church. We're thrilled to be hosting our own VBS. So if you have any questions, you can ask our children's ministry director, Melanie Beasley. But you'll probably get most of those questions answered if you just stick around after the service today for the training, and then come next week for the transformation of this place. It's a very exciting opportunity for us to engage with our neighbors and our community. So those are the announcements that I have. Children, I want to dismiss our children elementary who are going to be going to the elementary message to go ahead and meet over there. And Miss Megan Kuhn will be taking you. These kids will be coming back before the end of the service. And so we'll have you back in a glorious reunion with your families then. All right, now I want to invite Heather Kirkpatrick to come and read this morning's scripture passage. Heather, thank you. Thank you, Heather, for reading that passage for us this morning. So, this sermon is kind of a standalone. It's outside of any of the series that we've been doing. We have a few of these a year where we call them Pastor's Choice, where we can pick whatever we want to talk about. And I wanted to talk about this because it has to do with the subject of prayer, which is something that I think is increasingly just becoming a lost art in the life of the church and in the lives of believers. And it doesn't need to be that way. But in this passage, we see some things about prayer that I want to unpack a little bit. One of the things that we see is that we pray about what we care about. Because prayer is something that comes up from within us, in the heart, in the soul. The things that we appeal to the Creator, to the Maker, to the Sustainer of the universe, the things that we appeal to Him about, you could argue, are the most important things in our lives. And I don't necessarily mean thanking God for pizza before you eat it, but I mean like the deep heart-level cries of the soul that you carry and that I carry like a burden. In today's text, Paul is talking about what is stirring these deep waters of prayer in him. What keeps him up at night? And if we look at what Heather just read, we see that it's really about how we experience the love of Christ. That's what his prayer is. And so that's kind of the main idea, is this is a passage and a sermon about how we experience the love of Christ.
And it may on its surface seem like a really ordinary thing to bring up. And yet, if I were to ask you, well, how do you experience the love of Jesus Christ? Is it something that you kind of know about? But if you were to say, I don't know that I experience it. I don't know that it's something that I wake up in the morning and I fall to my knees in gratitude for the love of God every day. That's what I want us to get to. That's what I want us to think about here. Because Paul is talking about, you see it in the language of this. He said, I get on my knees before the Father, who under whom everybody in the world is named. And he says that I pray that you would be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, that our faith would not just be an adjective to describe us, but that it would be a waking reality for us all the time, that it would be a governing principle, a governing force, a cause for joy. He talks about being rooted and grounded in love, that our feet are planted in that. And if you go through this life feeling like my feet feel just unplanted all the time, I feel adrift in this world, that's what this passage is getting at, that we would be rooted and grounded. And he prays, I love this, he prays that we would be able to understand something that goes beyond what we can understand. That's very Pauline language. It's very like something Paul would say, right? Give them a depth of understanding that they don't have a capacity for. And what does he want us to know? He wants us to know the breadth and the length and the height and the width and the depth of the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. What sort of prayer is this that Paul is praying? On the surface, we see Paul is praying that we would be strengthened, right? He's praying that the church would be strengthened, certainly in the face of persecution, but that we would be strengthened deep within by the Holy Spirit, so that the bedrock foundation of our lives would rest on this astonishing comprehension of the love of Christ. In other words, he wants them to be so utterly captured by the love of God that it's foremost in their minds and hearts. And us too. This is what he wants for them. And we see it in the way that he expresses himself, that it flows in such a way that you can see that it's something he wants for himself too. But it's deeper than that. Look at Paul's posture. He says he's on his knees. He's kneeling before, this matters to him. He's praying that we would catch this know Christ in a way that surpasses knowing. What does that mean? Well, notice how there's nothing really clinical about what Paul's saying. People think of Paul a lot of times as a guy who can get really heady and really kind of academic and lofty. Even the Apostle Peter talked about Paul in this way. He said he sometimes thinks things that I don't understand, says things that I don't understand. But here, he's all heart. He's all in as far as his heart goes. And his heart is for the people who are hearing these words, that we would understand that the love of God is not a concept, but it's a real thing. It's a powerful force. And so he's modeling a kind of prayer that we should have for one another, that we would pray for each other with a kind of urgency and a passion, that we would know, that we would know, that we would know, that we would know that the love of God is real. And so this prayer, it kind of has the capacity to haunt us, because what he's saying, make me someone who wants your love to be the most precious thing in those that I love. Make your love so real and so tacit and so meaningful to the people that I love that it circles back and reminds me of your love. Move me in this kind of way. Move me to a kind of deeper knowing. Engage me in my inmost being. Dredge up the deep waters. I want to tell you a story that from me in middle school, that with a little bit of trepidation. And the reason is because in some ways I could come across as the hero of the story. And one of the codes that I live by is beware the man who makes himself the hero of his own story. And so I think if, as I tell it, you'll see that I'm not a hero in this story. Experiences of having to reckon with the reality of the love of God. Not just the idea of it, not just the you know, God loves you, but like, no, he really loves deeply in ways that will haunt you. And so give me grace as I get through it and show that I'm a confused little kid in this story, but I'm also a willing player in hoping to show who the true hero is, which is Christ. So during the first few years of our marriage, Lisa and I got a puppy. We got a little Shih Tzu that we named We were newlyweds. We didn't have any kids. We had all the time in the world. Why not? Puppies are fun. We had a small apartment. It was great. That's why we got him. How we chose his name was a different matter. Grady. I grew up with a kid named Grady. From kindergarten through 12th grade. It's funny. I should mention this. My eyes just welled up with tears saying his name. That factors in. So Grady was the funniest kid I had ever met. It was a little like kindergarten, first grade. I met him and I just thought, he is hilarious. The best jokes, just physical, he was physical comedy, and I really liked him. And the more I got to know him, the more I came to understand that there were parts of his story that were just different from mine. Mine was, for the most part, a pretty happy story. You know, my parents were together, we were doing okay, got along with my brother, and I was just a little kid, right? But parts of his story were very different from mine. Like when in fourth grade, I realized that I had never met his dad, and so I asked him about his dad, and his answer was, I don't have a dad. And that was it. And I had never heard of a thing like that. It never even occurred to me that, I mean, I knew parents divorced, but I didn't know that you could be a kid and not have a dad at all. So every summer, fast forwarding to middle school, I hung out at the city pool, small town Indiana, and we had a season pass you could buy at the beginning of summer. And to get in the pool, you just said your pass number. And I would go every day. It was my parents' form of daycare for us as middle schoolers and high schoolers. We just hung out at the pool every day. Not a drop of sunscreen to be found. And on one very hot day, like the kind we've been having for the last 30 or so, Grady and a few of his friends borrowed his mom's inflatable raft to float down the creek that went through our town. And they somehow punctured it, and the creek ran right along past the pool. And so when the raft started to sink, they were right by the pool, and so they stumbled up from the creek and came into the pool. Now, again, remember, we're seventh grade. These boys had been drinking. They'd been drinking all afternoon under the hot sun, and Grady was barely able to walk. And I remember seeing him and feeling worried about him. Though I didn't really understand the effects of alcohol, I could tell that he was just not present with us. This is seventh grade. And his friends were laughing at him. And they were laughing at how much he was struggling to just stand up. And then one of them shoved him into the pool. And he fell in, and he was helpless. And so I jumped in. And I brought him over to the edge of the pool. And he just looked at me confused, and he asked, what's going on? Like, he didn't know what was happening. And I told him, let me help you get home. He lived all the way on the other side of town. And he wanted to take the raft home and try to fix it. but he couldn't carry it in his condition and also walk. It had taken on a couple of gallons of creek water. And so I remember that I carried it for him, and I had to hug it because of the way it was. I had to just kind of carry it in my arms like this. It was heavy. And as we walked, he started to sober up, and he told me what they had done that day. And they had gotten some beer, and they'd been drinking warm beer all morning. And then we got to his house, and he just asked me, "Why are you doing this for me?" Now, run all of this, by the way, through the seventh grade boy translator. I might have added some eloquence to the conversation as a 40-something. But he asked me, "Why are you doing this?" He did ask me that. And I told him, "You're my friend, and I care about you." And I remember saying that to him, because I remember in the moment being surprised by how much I meant it. Like that feeling of that was a very true thing I just said to you. And I wanted him to have friends. I wanted him to have friends who didn't get him drunk and shove him into the pool and laugh at him. So time passed. We got older. We didn't really run in the same circles anymore. But for reasons that I couldn't have expressed then, the Lord put Grady on my heart. And my sophomore year was the transforming year where I knew that I belonged to Jesus. That was the year of my conversion to Christ. And I knew that my life would be shaped by that bond. And with that came a deeper concern for Grady that just, I didn't know how to explain it, because we didn't spend time together. Have any of you ever written mushy notes to someone in high school and passed them between class? I have. And for a while there, those notes were from me to Grady about the love of God for him. And they were about how I wanted him to know this love more than anything in my life. I wanted that. Now, after high school, we lost touch, and I haven't seen him since. Remember, I'm telling you all this in the context of Paul praying on his knees and saying, "What I want most for you is for you to know that the love of God is real and to know how high and deep and wide and long it is in Christ." Here's what I'll tell you. I haven't seen Grady in years. A couple of times a year, every year, since high school, I have had very vivid dreams about him. And they're all the same. And they're me pleading with him to know Jesus. And I can't explain why, of all people, because I've known hundreds of people who need to know the love of Christ, why he's the one that comes into my dreams. But I can tell you, every time I wake up from that dream, I'm filled with a hope. And it's a familiar hope. If this is your first Sunday, I don't do this every week. Maybe a third of the weeks I get right to the edge, though. The hope is this. It's the feeling that I had when he asked me why I was carrying his punctured raft in seventh grade. And it's that I wanted him to have a father. I wanted him to know. Oh. And so, since the Lord set this strange pattern of dreams about Grady coming to know the love of God, we named our dog after him so that I would remember to pray for him.
We don't have the dog anymore, but sometimes I still have the dream. Let me tell you how those dreams have worked in my life. First, they awaken in me a real longing not just to share my religion, but to know. And so I pray for that, for God to work cosmically, and that God would strengthen Grady to his core. And every time, this is convicting to me because I don't assume that posture very often. Which really leads me to the second thing these dreams awaken in me, and that is they haunt me. I have to ask, is what I want for Grady still something I want for me? Because I can be pretty committed to try. We look for to strengthen us deep within. It's a question of what do we look for to strengthen us deep within. Paul isn't praying for a vacant part of our hearts, whatever's left over, to be filled with Christ. He's praying for all of our hearts to be filled with Christ. And he's praying that the focus of our inner lives would be on Christ first. He's praying, God, dredge up the bottoms of our inner lives and take us deeper. Sanctify my messiness. And the question is, do you want this? I don't know whatever came of those, I'm certain, awkward letters that I wrote to Grady all those years ago. I resisted folding them in a crafty way. I just folded it up and handed it to him. I didn't want it to be weird, but I don't know what came of those letters. I don't know if he kept them. I did ask him one time if he read them, and he said that he did. And I don't entirely know why I have the recurring dream where I'm pleading with him when I haven't spoken to him in years. But I know that those dreams and those memories that go with them stir something inside of me that not only awakens a deep love for my friend still, but also an awareness that I need people to pray such things for me. I need you to pray that way for me. I need to pray that way for you too. Because when it comes to tending to our inmost being, we can be just easily lulled to sleep. So those dreams wake me up. What would it look like for us to possess what Paul is praying in such a way that we walk in it? When something happens that makes us feel unrooted, like a relationship breaks and needs mending, or a job offer doesn't come through in the way that we hoped, we would know to confess that the uprooted feeling that we feel doesn't mean we really are uprooted, because we're rooted in the love of Christ. Instead, we would know that this uprooted feeling is there because we're finding our foundation in something far less secure than the length and the breadth and the height and the depth of the love of God that is ours in Christ. Our prayers would shift from, God, give me what I want, to, God, anchor the desires of my heart in the sobriety of knowing your Spirit is working in and through my life. That's my prayer for us, is that we would know the love of Christ in such a way that our desire for other people to know the love of Christ would haunt us and would wake us up and would find its way into our dreams, and that in the process of that happening, it would remind us that the depth of the love of God in Christ that we so want this other person to know is the very same depth and love of Christ that the Father has for you and for me. Let me pray. Father, I thank you for the ways that you work over time. Maybe the reason for my tender heart is talking about Grady on the heels of receiving children as communing members and baptizing children and recognizing that we believe that you are faithful over time in ways that are beyond the scope of our reach, that you do immeasurably more than all that we ask or think. And so, Lord, we pray, one, that you would stir in our hearts a depth of understanding of your love for us, and that you would draw us deeper into it, and that you would use our lives to contend for others, as Paul does in this passage, for others to know how really your love for them. And Father, we thank you that it's true, that it's all true. And we pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen and amen. Okay. All right, well, we come to the communion table now, which is kind of perfect, isn't it, to come to the communion table where we're given this tangible reminder, this sacrament applied to our senses of touch and taste and smell, this experience where we'll have a little bite of carb and a little shot of sugar, and our appetites will awaken and say, more of that, please. Because it's a reminder to us that this faith that we walk in is not just an academic exercise. It's not just a set of beliefs that we assent to and say, okay, these are the things that I'm going to believe. It's the love of God in Christ for you. And so we come to the table as a way of remembering and engaging with the depth and the breadth and the height and the length and the wonder of it. The way we do communion here is these two sides of the room will come down this aisle over here, and Bruce Williams, one of our elders, will be over at that table. You'll take the elements and hold them and take them all together as soon as he's spoken a word of blessing. Nate Yoder will be over at this table as well. If you would like prayer during communion for any reason whatsoever, Trevor Pavey would love to pray with you and for you in the back of the room back there. This table is a table that we do every week as a way of returning again and again to the centrality of what it is that we believe, and that is that our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness, and because of his love. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, later he took the cup and he blessed it and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the remission of your sin." The Apostle Paul said, "Whenever we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." It's real. It's ongoing, the love of Christ. Because this table is a profession of faith, proclaiming, it is a table for Christians. If you're here and you would say, it wouldn't be accurate to identify myself as a Christian, glad that you're here. Welcome. We want to ask you to observe rather than to partake, because to partake is to profess faith, and we want everybody to come to the table with integrity. But we want you to come to the table and observe, because it's not just Christians here in this room who do this, but it's a Christian sacrament. Around the world, Christians come to this table as a way of saying, "This is my hope is in Christ, taking my sin upon himself and robing me in his righteousness through his life. Because that's the case, we come to the table, all of us, either to observe or to partake as a way of understanding what Christ has done and to commune with him. We do encourage you to get chatty during this. You know, the handshake of peace, only in a longer way. But we'll do that now as we commune with one another and commune with the Lord. But first, let's turn our eyes and hearts to the screen and let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Passover has been sacrificed for the people of God. Come to the table.
Never been, there will never be a God like you, a love so true. There has never been, there will never be a God like you, a love so true.
Let's all stand together and sing one last song together and worship. In just a minute.
verses that I'm going to read as a benediction are actually the following
verses after our text, which is comes together into a doxology.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son,
amen. Stick around for the field guide training for VBS right here after the service. There's lunch out there. And have a great Sunday, everybody.